should have been a man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent a message to the king. Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me, that he may learn that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman came with his horses and chariots, and halted at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, Go, wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean. But Naaman became angry and went away, saying, I thought that for me he would surely come out, and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and would wave his hand over the spot, and cure the leprosy. Are not Havana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? He turned and went away in a rage. But his servants approached and said to him, Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it? How much more, when all he said to you was, Wash and be clean. So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. His flesh was restored like the flesh of a young boy, and he was clean. Word of the Lord.
Holy Spirit, remove me. Put yourself in. Do what you need to do. Pray all this in your name. Amen. How many of you are terrible with names? Okay, a few of us. I'm usually pretty good with names, but if you challenge me enough, I'm going to mess something up. For instance, second year of my youth ministry at Good Shepherd Presbyterian Church. I'm getting ready to go to junior high when I can. And I have 2 registration forms in my mailbox. I look at them, and the names on them are Jamie Fernandez Jr. and Jamie Fernandez III. I think somebody's playing a joke on me. So I call the phone number on it, and sure enough, Jamie Fernandez Jr. and Jamie Fernandez III are coming to junior high. I've never seen them before, never heard of them before, and here they are coming to camp. And they come in, and I assumed they were twins, but I didn't assume they would be identical twins. And they get out of the car, and they look exactly alike. So I go up to them, and I say, you must be the Fernandez boys. And they say, actually, we go by Gigi and Jim Boy. How was I going to tell which one was Gigi and Jim Boy that whole weekend? That whole weekend, I completely butchered their names. And it took me a couple months to realize which one was which. Mainly because of their personality. Gigi was a little bit more anxious, needed to know exactly what was happening. Jim Boy was a little bit more relaxed. And I was telling one of my volunteers, that's how I tell them apart. And he goes, Warner, Gigi wears his watch on the right hand and Jim Boy wears his watch on the left hand. That story doesn't have much to do with the passage today, but I bring it up because I need to do a very quick Bible 101. In the passage today, we deal with the prophet Elijah. And growing up in Sunday school, I would always get him mixed up with the prophet Elijah. This is where you can tell that English is my second language because I say Elijah and Elijah almost the same way. So that makes it even more confusing to me. And here, both of the prophets, they're both in the book of Kings, they hang out together, and it's very easy to get them confused. They might as well be named Jamie Fernandez Jr. and Jamie Fernandez III. So before we dive into the passage, I will do a quick recap of who these two are. So first, we are introduced to Elijah in 1 Kings 17. Elijah predicts a drought in the land that is completely devastating for that land. And then he's in this epic competition with the prophets of Baal. They have a competition to see which God would provide fire for the offering first. And Elijah and God win. Does this start to sound familiar from a few weeks ago? prophet Elijah. He is constantly calling out King Ahab and Queen Jezebel for injustices that they are doing. So his life is always in danger. Eventually, God tells Elijah to anoint Elijah as a prophet as well. And they start to have this mentorship kind of role. And last week we saw Leanne preach about Elijah ascending up into heaven, but not without Elijah receiving a double portion of his spirit and prophetic wisdom. So in a sense, Elijah has passed the baton to Elijah, and Elijah now is established as the prophet in the land. And he's known as a miracle worker and a healer, which is really important to our passage today. So two different people. Up until a few years ago, I thought they were the same person. We have Elijah and Elijah, Gigi and Jim Boy. Elijah is who we are dealing with today. And as we have seen in the book of Kings, these have been completely odd stories, and this one doesn't fall short. It is a completely odd story, but it starts off with this man named Naaman. He is the captain of the army of Aram. He is a great warrior, and the king of Aram has great favor in him. And this is where it gets a little weird, because God has granted him victories. Aram is usually the enemy of Israel. And here God is granting him victories. And it's completely unusual. We assume that this is probably a time of peace between both countries. So God and the king of Aram have favor on him. He's a great warrior. But then it says that he has leprosy. Today, leprosy is known as Hansen's disease. There is a clear diagnosis for leprosy today. But back in scripture, there was not a clear diagnosis. It was a variety of different skin diseases. We don't know exactly what he had, but it was enough of an annoyance for him that he wanted to do something about it. So here we have this great warrior who has a skin disease. And then his wife's servant notices and says, I have a guy for you. There's this prophet of Samaria. He will help you out. Again, these stories are odd. His wife's servant is a young captive Israelite who the Armenians took in one of the raids. She should be somebody who has lost all hope and all faith, but she's the one who brings a possible solution. I know a guy. And I think if I was in her situation, I would say, no, forget God. Forget this prophet. They have forgotten about me. But she brings a solution. So Naaman goes to the king of Aram and tells him what this young captive Israelite woman says. And he says, sweet, do what you need to do to get healed. I'll write a letter to the king of Israel and we'll send a gift and you will see this prophet and you will be healed. Sending the letter was a sign of diplomacy, and the huge size of that gift realized how significant Naaman's condition actually was. So Naaman takes this letter to the king of Israel. He says, can I please see Elijah? And the king of Israel tears his clothes and thinks this is a ploy for them to attack him later. Completely forgets about the prophet Elijah, tears his clothes, and thinks it's a ploy. Here the king, the person who should have complete faith in the miraculous works of the prophet, doesn't even think about it. It was the young captive Israelite woman who has faith. Where here the king, the one who should, is the one who does not. There's a reversal of roles. And Elijah hears that the king has torn his clothes, and he sends a message. It says, tell Naaman to come over here, so that he may know that there's a prophet here in Israel. And Elijah sends a message to the king, and Naaman comes over and waits at the doorstep. This is a sign of respect. But Elijah doesn't come out. He sends a messenger. He sends a messenger to tell Naaman, go wash yourself in the Jordan 7 times, and you will be healed. Now, Naaman is a little angry. He feels that since he went through all this trouble to go on a journey, and because of all the gifts that he brought, that surely something great needed to be done. And I kind of feel for Naaman. Elijah's being a little bit rude. I think if I was in Naaman's spot, I would say, I came all this way, and you couldn't even come out of your house, offer me a cup of tea. No, instead, wash myself in the Jordan 7 times. I have rivers back home. I don't need to do that here. This is ridiculous. I'm just going home. So yes, Naaman has a point. Elijah was being a little bit rude. But Naaman is not really disappointed with Elijah's rudeness. Naaman is upset with the lackluster thing he needed to be done to be healed. He was a great warrior. He was a great man. He expected something great to be healed, perhaps some kind of magic. So he leaves in a rage, and his servants, they intervene and they say, "My father, not my lord, my father," which is very uncommon for a servant to say to his master. But this shows that they have some personal connection to Naaman. They say, "If Elijah told you to do something great, wouldn't you have done it? Just do this simple task and perhaps you will be healed." Essentially, they tell Naaman to check his pride and humble himself and do the simple task that Elijah recommended. And again, we see a reversal of roles. The young captive Israelite woman has faith, where the king does not. The servants want to go through with the plan, where the great warrior did not. So Naaman listens to his servants, and it says that he went down and immersed himself 7 times. He went down has a double meaning, because he literally had to go down into the Jordan River, but he also had to go down symbolically and humble himself. His pride was something great, but he had to humble himself and do the simple thing to receive healing. And it says that once he was healed, his skin was that like of a young child. One of the commentaries I read said this: on his way to a cure from leprosy, the big man was forced into submission to the prophet and transformed symbolically to a young boy. Naaman needed to be humbled to accept grace. Naaman needed to be humbled to experience healing. So when I think about healing and God's grace, I think about how us at the church sometimes feel entitled, not just here at Kingston, but all over the global church. And there are 2 dangers that come with entitlement. The first is that we feel so entitled that we want great things just like Naaman. But on the other side of the coin, sometimes we feel like we cannot do enough to accept grace. These 2 dangers are incredibly dangerous, and we need humbleness to restore both. We have to go down like Naaman and did and become like a young child. We either have to humble ourselves down and realize that we are not as great as we think we are, or we have to humble ourselves and accept grace even when we do not feel enough. And I think both are incredibly hard. I was 20 years old when I first started working at Good Shepherd Presbyterian Church. And the pastors there did an absolutely great job of putting me in places of leadership that somebody as young as 20 shouldn't have. But they took risks, and I will always be grateful. I was 20 when I did my first sermon in big church. I would speak at youth, but they allowed me to speak at big church a couple times. And my first 2 sermons went really well. But my 3rd sermon, both the pastors were going to be out of town. And they had full confidence in me that I would be able to run the show. And I say show because that Sunday was going to be the runner show. I prepared a great sermon. In fact, I had to lead the band that day. Forget that I'm a terrible singer, I was going to be a rock star that Sunday. So I had the sermon plan, the music was going to be great, and I go up to play the first song, and I have my capo, which changes the key on the guitar, on the wrong fret. So I'm already a terrible singer, but I'm playing a song in the wrong key from the rest of the band, and I'm singing out of tune. It was a disaster. Then my sermon came. This was the first time I experienced somebody falling asleep in my sermon. Now, I don't get bummed out about it anymore. Now I understand that some people need some extra holy rest. Back then, it was completely devastating to my ego. Then community. It was time for community. And the pastors forgot to have somebody preside over it. So I said, "This time for communion," and nobody walks up, and I'm just standing there feeling completely naked. And I awkwardly come and break the bread, and we have a pitcher that we pour into the cup, and I pour the cup into the pitcher instead. And everything that could have gone wrong in that service went wrong. A couple days later, Curtis called me, and he said, "Warner, how did the service go?" Said, "It was terrible." I still have a vivid image in my head of leaning over the rail of my apartment, just distraught, telling him how bad the service was. And he goes, Warner, I'm so sorry. One of us should have been there to help me out. And then something hit me, and I said, Curtis, it's actually my fault. I forgot to pray. I forgot to let the Spirit do what it needed to do. I had this gross, arrogant, like, confidence. I didn't pray. I was great. I felt entitled. I was ready for it to be the Warner Show. And I was humbled that day. One of the most important lessons I learned that Sunday is that I also needed grace. I needed grace because I couldn't do it alone. I need grace because of my sense of pride and my sense of entitlement blinded me from God's grace. But on the other side of the coin, sometimes it's hard to accept grace because we feel like we need to earn it. And then when we blow it as a Christian, we feel completely unworthy. And we feel like we don't deserve God's grace. Rachel Held Evans in her book, Searching for Sunday, say, this is why we need the Eucharist. This is why we need communion. Because at the table, we come in with open hands to receive grace. At the table, we quit keeping score of our feeling of greatness and unworthiness. At the table, grace triumphs over our pride, our entitlement, and our need to earn and deserve salvation. At the table, God's grace poured out in Jesus tells us that we are worthy, that we can experience grace. In a few moments, we are coming to the table. And if you want, I'm going to leave these papers here. If you want to step over it to receive with open hands, do so. If you need to step on it and stomp on it, you can do that. Friends, being humble is like Naaman and myself. It's not to put us down. Being humble gives us access to accepting grace. So as we come to the table today, let's enter into grace together. Amen.